When you talk about total knee replacement in neuropathic joints, it was originally described as an arthritic sequelae of neurosyphilis by Charcoat in 1868. It is caused by a combination of sensory, motor and autonomic neuropathy. When first described, it was mainly associated with tapis dorsalis resulting from tertiary syphilis. Diabetes is now recognized as the most common cause. Alcoholism, syringomyelia and leprosy are few other causes. A Charcoat knee symptomatically is painful and unstable, and the knee is one of the most frequently affected large joints. The theories postulated are the neurotraumatic and the neurotropic theories. Eichenholz in 1966 published a monograph entitled Charcoat Joints, in which clinical, radiographic and pathologic data of 68 consecutive patients were used to define the stages of Charcoat arthropathy based on the natural history of the condition. The various stages given were the prodromal stage, in which swelling, erythema and warmth is present. However, there are no radiologic findings. In the developmental stage, there is swelling, erythema and warmth with ligamentous laxity. In X-ray, you'll see osteopenia, fragmentation, joint subluxation or dislocation. In coalescence stage, there is decreased warmth, swelling and erythema with absorption of debris, sclerosis and fusion of larger fragments. In reconstruction stage, there is absence of warmth, swelling and erythema. And in X-ray, there will be fibrous ankylosis, rounding and smoothing of bone fragments. So the progression from onset to consolidation runs through the stages as described by Eichenholz. Progression from one stage to other may last from weeks or months to several years, although sometimes the process is arrested in the early stages. So treatment options include conservative arthrodesis or arthroplasty. For the arthroplasty of the Charcoat knee, phase of the disease is an important factor to consider. The disease should have completely passed its destructive phase before the surgical intervention can be considered. This can be determined radiologically using the Eichenholz stages of the disease. So coming to the literature review, Thibault et al. Recently published a paper on 37 operated knees with a complication rate of 39%. Varus valgus constraint was used in 46% of cases, rotating hinge in 35% and posterior stabilized in 19% of the cases. This study found that the selective use of increased constraint and enhanced component fixation with stems and or metaphyseal cones led to significant improvement in clinical outcomes and excellent survivorship free of aseptic revision at 10 years in the majority. Wins in 2005 used a constrained knee which had to be removed due to dislocation and infection. Dr. Pervezi in 2003 published a report of 40 knees that had a complication rate of 35%. 85% were free of revision in 8 years and 82.5% were free of mechanical failure. There was extensive bone fragmentation and severe defects present in 90% of the cases, because of which metal augments, autologous bone grafting and bone allografts had to reinforce. There was also an improvement in knee pain and range of motion. Sodri used custom processes and PS condyler and reported satisfactory results. Kim published a study of 19 knees. He used constrained knees in 89% of the patients, has a complication rate of 47%. 53% of his patients were satisfactory at a mean follow-up of 5 years, and 31% were functioning poorly. Yasin reports a case of single patient with rotating hinge, which shows progressive osteolysis within 1 year of follow-up that had to be removed. So the choice of processes in all these studies is constrained knee followed by a long stem and rotating hinge. So to conclude, with the growing number of diabetic patients, the presentation of symptomatic neuropathic arthropathy is likely to become more frequent. It should always be suspected in every diabetic patient with peripheral neuropathy who presents with a red hot swollen joint. Even when the diagnosis is only suspected, immediate immobilization and offloading is recommended. Surgical intervention may be required in chronic cases with joint instability or severe deformity. The surgeon must be careful that the destructive phase of the disease has ceased before surgery is attempted, and the patient must be fully aware of the risks of the failure. Meticulous attention should be directed at alignment and ligament balancing. The use of stems constrained and additional metaphyseal fixation to improve on the success of TKA is paramount. There is very limited medical literature regarding arthroplasty of Charcoat knees, with very few case series and reports. There is no clear consensus regarding the use of a particular prosthesis. Every case has to be tailored according to the patient's need. Unclear whether the underlying pathology has an effect on longer term outcome, and larger study cohorts in the future may help solve this dilemma. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions? And as part of your study, did you have a cohort of Charcoat joints that you followed up?
Yes, sir. We have operated on 2 patients, and we have a cohort of 2 cases for a follow-up of 2 years. The patients were doing good. We have used a posterior stabilized knee, but one patient had a trivial fall after 1.5 years.